Hello and welcome to News Click. This is a program which we called Present, Past and the Future, and I am Nilanjan Mukhopadhyay, the host for this program. Today we are going to talk about Ayodhya, an issue for which we have been talking about for decades in India, and it's actually dictated the flow of politics in India for at least since the 1980s. In the last few weeks, the Ayodhya issue has roared back to life, primarily because of two Supreme Court verdicts. One was actually to say that an observation made in the two-decade-old judgment that a mosque is not integral to Islam. On that, there was a verdict. And then again, a four-minute hearing of the Supreme Court, Chief Justice of India said that Ayodhya issue, the title suit which is pending, is not their priority. And in January, they shall decide that whether it is going to be heard on a daily basis, which bench is going to hear it. Those various issues are going to be decided in January. It is not a priority matter. Now, this has led to a backlash from the Sangh Parivar. The RSS chief, Mohan Bhagwat, has already said that the temple is absolutely essential at this stage. There's a lot of exasperation being expressed right from the Uttar Pradesh Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath to various other people saying that the Supreme Court is not being correct by delaying the thing, that it is actually a great priority matter. Now, so we are actually moving towards some kind of thing, what I call an endgame as far as Ayodhya issue is concerned. And to discuss this, I am joined today by Venkitesh Ramakrishnan, who has been a fellow journalist for almost more than three decades. In fact, Venkitesh, I say that collectively I and you have 64 years of Ayodhya reporting, absolutely. Right from 1986 onwards. Yeah. You know, we have spent many an afternoon in very languid atmospheres in Ayodhya. And seen it through a lot of turbulence.
Absolutely.
There's something which has been bothering me in the last few days, that in 92, much before December 6th, 1992, we knew that the mosque is going to be demolished. You know, even before, you know, we actually confirmed and did stories speaking on the basis of your conversations with Vinay Katyar, who actually shared that how engineering analysis had been done of the Babri Masjid to know exactly which spots had to be hammered to bring it down very fast. At that time, it was certain. There was a kind of an preordained destiny that it is going to be demolished. I am not able to put my finger on as to what is happening now.
There is no doubt the Ayodhya temple is going to be built. I mean, and I think if it is possible, they would build it before the term of this government is over. The only problem...
They'll build it or they will begin building it.
They will begin building it.
Unlike the demolition, the mosque cannot be built in a day.
Yeah, yeah.
The temple cannot be built in a day.
Prefabrication, see, there are various claims about prefabrication.
Right.
So, I've gone to Karsevakpuram repeatedly in the last 10 years. And I have spoken to a lot of people who are in charge of, incidentally, the man who is in charge of demolition is now in charge of the prefabrication.
Right. Who is this man?
Mr. Rai. Champak Rai is in charge of...
He's been a long VHP.
He is now in charge of the prefabrication.
Okay.
And
prefabrication... So it is under his supervision, everything has been done. All they have to do is actually go and put it together
the screws. There are various claims about it. They are saying that they can put it up in 1 week, they can put it up in 10 days, 15 days. I tend to kind of take all that with a pinch of salt, right, as like many of their arguments. But what I think is going to happen, that the issue of Ram temple is going to come up, and along with that the issue of the other two temples. In fact, if you remember the slogan,
ye to bas jhaki hai, Mathura Kashi baki hai.
So I think we are going to see a big focus on Kashi, and there are a lot of things happening in Varanasi at this point of time.
Mm-hmm. Like?
Like, for example, there's the construction of what is called Ganga pathway, Ganga corridor. Is under construction. And they have identified about 300 structures around the Kashi Vishwanath temple, which includes both Hindu structures, neutral structures and Muslim structures. And I think work is progressing on that. And my own gut feeling is that, you know, that you will have a very explosive situation in Varanasi in the next few months.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and parallelly, and Ayodhya, this whole game plan in Ayodhya will also move forward. And I think, you know, collectively, we are going to have a huge, massive revival of the Hindutva plank.
I have a question that in Ayodhya, you also have this huge Ram statue also coming up. In Varanasi, they are also building a Ganga pathway, as you kind of said. So these alternate constructions, which is it not kind of a fallback, something that if the real temple does not work out, at least people, let them have a big statue of Ram in Ayodhya?
No, I see it in a different thing. I mean, the point is, you know, that there may still be people who say that why is the temple not built even after you got 5 years, you got majority, huge majority at the center, huge majority in the states. And I think a lot of Hindutva supporters are going to ask that question. So this statue is a fallback option for that.
Right.
But I think what is happening in Varanasi is more substantive. It is almost as decisive as what happened in Ayodhya in 1992.
Okay. So they're actually going about identifying structures which could be targeted in the next few months. How it is going to happen, it's not yet very clear. Now, obviously, it means that there is a huge amount of, a very serious attempt to create a platform which we can call as the Hindutva Plus platform, you know, which is not just the Hindutva as we used to know earlier, that not just the Ram temple issue, but many other issues, Ram temple or the other temple issues. But there are various other issues also being linked up, whether it is in regard to beef eating, cow protection, or whether it is in love jihad, or even now what has happened is the recent spate of renaming of cities and towns, you know, Ayodhya district, Faizabad district being renamed as Ayodhya. These are all various kind of small low-hanging fruit which is being done. There is also, of course, this long-pending demand of theirs that even at some point, you know, once we have complete control, the name India should also be changed. You know, in fact, Jay Dubashi had written an article in The Organizer called saying that we should rename it Hindu Desh because then our nationality is going to be Hindu. So whether the Muslim man likes it or not, when he goes for Hajj, his passport is stamped that he is a Hindu. So everybody is a Hindu, so there is no majority or minority. Now, the question is that is this being done because the development plank, which was put up front in 2013, 2014, has not really worked. This government has really not delivered on its promises. And does it also mean that it is they really think that there is no other way that they can win an election?
No, I'm hearing this from many people in the recent past. But if you really look at the 2013-14 campaign plank, it was not entirely just development.
Of course not.
Yeah, it was. It had.
He
it
kept on calling Rahul Gandhi a Shehzade. He kept on calling Delhi ka Sultanate.
No, in fact, if you remember, 2013 September, exactly 10 months before the elections,
right,
you had this massive riots in Western Uttar Pradesh, which killed so many people, and the kind of reverberations it created.
Had riots not happened, BJP would not have won 73 seats along with allies.
So, you know, I don't know why we are saying that development plank has failed. The thing is, you know, that there was this communal angle. The Hindutva politics was always part and parcel of the BJP's, election plank, whether it is thematic or practical. Only thing is that, you know, that they have been even a bigger failure than
that. Let's put it this way, that in 2013-14, development was put on the table first. Hindutva was there always in the background. But now it is the Hindutva Plus, whether it's Ram, whether it is the Varanasi issue, love jihad, renaming of cities, this is being put up front that we are doing it. Stop it if you can. And development is the issue is at the back of the career. And we are going to talk about what this government has achieved in the last 5 years, various schemes which has been done. We have provided, you know, bank accounts to everybody. We have provided health insurance, etc., etc.
No. I'll tell you something. I'll tell you something which I had heard in the first year of governance. The first year of the government, you know, there were people who were talking about the kind of big things that Modi was planning to do in terms of, not only in terms of development, but in terms of changing the basic governance mechanism of this country. So, what I was told by some people who claimed to be very close to Modi and whom I know are some of them are pretty close to the Prime Minister. They were saying that, you know, that in the first year of government, the Prime Minister will make sure that 50 politicians, senior politicians, are in the jail for corruption, in corruption cases, convicted in corruption cases, cutting across party lines. It was said that, you know, that there will be Congress fellows, there will be BJP people, there will be
NCP. But it has not happened.
It has not happened.
So, is it going to be in the last year?
No, no. I don't see that there's any kind of point. Is, if you have to take something to conviction, there is some groundwork that's to be done. So that groundwork
has not been done.
It has not been done by any investigating agencies, and you know what the situation in our premier investigating agency is. So
busy investigating one another.
Yeah. Central Bureau of Intrigue.
Yeah.
So
that's a nice. Nice way to call the CBI.
Yeah. So, what I'm saying is that, you know, all these big promises were there. So, their own estimation, that is in the estimation of diehard fans of the Prime Minister and his chief acolyte, Mr. Amit Shah, in their own estimation, they have failed. In their own estimation, they say that, you know, that we have not been able to do what had to be done. So, it is very, very evident for every one of them, including, you know, the karyakartas and the kar sevaks, the potential kar sevaks, that they have only this plank. How
can
it is
only
going
put the Hindus against Muslims and only that way consolidate the Hindu voter.
So, but exactly how it is going to roll out?
Would this be enough to get the 10% extra that it would require from what it had in 2013, 14? 31% is what
that's
they
a question.
Had, you know,
that
is this really going to
that's
work?
That's a question I would not want to answer at this point of time, because I think, you know, because the situation on the ground is very fluid. There are two factors which I've been seeing in the last 1 year consistently. There is colossal disillusionment about the government.
Right.
There is colossal disillusionment about the BJP as a political organization.
Right.
There is marginal disillusionment on Modi as the Prime Minister,
right,
in spite of his huge failures, colossal failures. There are these arguments which are being raised in his favor by the BJP organizational, Sangh Parivar organizational structure, which you know very well is a very powerful missionary.
Right.
And that has some traction. It is not as though it does not have traction. Right. I'll give you a small example. One of my friends was doing a kind of survey for a corporate house in Rajasthan. So he came up with this interesting thing. Vasundhara Raj's popularity was down to 17%. Ashok Gehlot had a chief ministerial approval rating of 57%. Mm-hmm. Sachin Pilot had an approval rating of 23%. Mm-hmm. But Modi's
approval rating as Prime Minister
was close to 70. Which is a fact that, you know, that it was.
So then,
it was in the range of 85 to 90 in 2014.
Does it mean then we are in a situation where the past trend of whoever performs well in Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan and Chhattisgarh, as we have seen in the past three elections, has also tended to win the majority of seats in the subsequent parliamentary elections? That this may not be the trend this time, that it is quite possible that the BJP may end up losing Rajasthan, maybe even one or two other states, you know, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, yet do very well in the Lok Sabha elections when they're held in a few months. It is possible.
The central question is how they are going to do in Uttar Pradesh. I think, you know, this is a factor which we talked about, you know, that people who have won Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh have won the central elections. But I think more importantly, the 2019 Lok Sabha elections are going to be decided in.
So we are back to whoever wins UP wins India. It's also, we are now also in the 25th year of the 93 assembly elections in UP. And first time ever, the most unlikely political alliance, Kanshi Ram and Mulayam Singh Yadav. None of them are actually players now. It's the Mayawati and Akhilesh now are players. They got together. After Babri Masjid, BJP learnt very bitterly that great ideas do not convert electorally always, that mathematics can always be against you. How is the mathematics? You also travel extensively to UP. Half the time you're there in Uttar Pradesh.
Yeah.
How is it building up there? There is an alliance, if the Congress and the RLD do not come.
If there is an SP-BSP alliance, and if they are able to manage the caste equations in the constituencies properly in terms of candidature, I won't be surprised if the BJP comes down to single digits.
If it really works out very well. Yeah. But if that really happens, then it is a huge thing.
That is where this massive revival and aggressive revival of the Hindutva politics.
The most dangerous aspect of this aggressive revival, the way the BJP is plotting the narrative, is that they are challenging the judiciary. They are trying to create a situation. You understand Kerala also very well, not just because you're from that state, but also because you have had very keenly followed events there. Shabrimala, I think, we have created a situation where a court verdict has been allowed to be challenged by People's Court. So has a precedent been set? You can very well say that the People's Court reject whatever Supreme Court is saying on Ayodhya. They don't want to do a hearing. We don't bother about the hearing. We are going to start construction. If tomorrow 10,000 people suddenly very sneak up into Ayodhya and with the prefabricated structures land up one morning, we wake up and see that and then through the
night.
They
can create a scene. See, if you remember in 1992, also they violated the assurance they gave.
Was permitted by the Rajiv Gandhi government, even though it was within the disputed territory. They deliberately said, it is outside. They used a map which was not
There was a sleight of hand there.
Yeah.
Here, they gave an assurance to Supreme Court saying that we will do only bhajan and kirtan as part of Karseva. And they came and demolished it. And on the day before the demolition, Vajpayee says, bhajan kirtan can also mean that, you can't just
samtal karenge.
There will be boulders which will have to be cleared. So, giving enough indication as to what they are going to do. So, this violation of Supreme Court orders or violation of the Constitution is nothing new to the Hindutva Brigade. They have done it repeatedly. They are doing it. In Kerala, what has happened is they have got a new icon in the form of Ayyappa, who is actually not even a Hindu god. So they have now constructed this narrative around Lord Ayyappa in Kerala, just as they created this narrative around Lord Ram in Ayodhya in the 1980s and 90s. Mm. It's a very well structured plan. It's a plan which is being repeatedly practiced and advanced. And what they did in Ayodhya was also similar to what they are doing in Ayodhya in Varanasi at this point of time.
We have also seen in the last three and a half decades since the Ayodhya agitation has been on, right from 1984-83 onwards when it was started, there have been occasions when there have been divisions within the Sangh Parivar. You have had various petty personality clashes. In the last few years, the VHP was completely out of sync. Both during Ashok Singhal's time also, it had a different kind of vision. How do you see the internal dynamics of within the Sangh Parivar? If I ask you that, according to me, that possibly the unity level, the index of unity within the Sangh Parivar is among the most highest that we have ever seen. Would you agree with it?
I think I would agree with that. Though, I think the top brass, the divisions within the top brass are much more palpable and sharp now than it was earlier. See, if you look at the outfits, the index of opposition or index of unity within the Sangh Parivar outfits, it is much higher, but not necessarily among the individuals in the top brass.
So, which means that collectively, as far as the cadre is concerned, that there is a certain amount of unanimity that we must do what is being pursued by this government, that this greater push to Hindutva is something for which we must come together, even if it means forsaking or sacrificing some of our other issues.
Absolutely.
For instance, the BMS has hardly been aggressive in the trade union front.
Absolutely.
It has been losing in support to the other trade unions. Yeah. So is the case with the Kisan Sabha. So there are challenges.
No, in fact, I think the kind of subjugation to authority or central authority among the Sangh Parivar outfits is near total complete.
So, finally, as we get into the conclusive part of this discussion, that between now and the next elections, you actually see some real construction work beginning, something symbolic like that. We really do not know. They are capable of coming up with very unique.
No, it can happen. Plans. What I am apprehensive or I'm actually fearful of is of large scale mayhem and violence across the Ganga Brahmaputra belt. Not just Ganga, but the Brahmaputra.
Even Brahmaputra, which means that Northeast also gets affected.
I would put it that way. I mean, construction and all that will be a minor episode in this large-scale mayhem that may happen.
How can the opposition at this stage, you know, do something to prevent what is being planned?
We do not know real politics that well or to give an advice. But then I have been trying to warn people, but then it's all what we can do at this point of time. There is no way we can say that, you know, that this is a solution to prevent it.
Venkatesh, thank you very much. It's been, we are ending on a rather depressive note because there is this fear of major communal build-up as we get closer to the elections. We have had a short conversation as to how the Ayodhya agitation is actually moving towards an end game. We really do not know to what extent this is going to have an impact on the elections. Thank you.